The next item of order on the order paper is a motion on Japanese knotweed. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
This Assembly calls on the Minister of Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs to bring forward proposals for a regional programme to eradicate Japanese knotweed.
Call Mrs. Pam Cameron to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I welcome the opportunity to be able to propose this motion today and hope that in highlighting the issue we can bring forward a strategy to deal with this problem of Japanese knotweed. By way of background, Japanese knotweed is an alien invasive plant species introduced to the United Kingdom in the 19th century as an ornamental shrub. Since its introduction, it has spread ferociously and without obstruction, particularly on waste ground and along watercourses. The plant is so well established that it is not included on the EU list of invasive species and it is unlikely to ever be wiped out. It becomes rapidly established in tall thickets, preventing the growth of native species. In doing so, it chokes waterways, hedgerows, and greatly reduces local biodiversity. The blight of invasive species is amongst the greatest threat to biodiversity and ecosystems globally, and is viewed as being a major hazard to the character of our heritage. The environment and, of course, the benefits a diverse ecosystem provides. The impact it can have on built environment is also a great concern. Japanese knotweed can penetrate through concrete and tarmac and cause structural damage to buildings. This is particularly distressing for householders who have found themselves in a position where their property becomes virtually worthless due to the mortgage company's reluctance to lend on homes that have been affected or even in the proximity to an infestation of Japanese knotweed. The ability of the plant to spread is unparalleled. It can be spread from the very smallest amount of a cut stem, crown or rhizome, thus making the removal and disposal incredibly difficult and often can only be dealt with by specialists. The Invasive Species Strategy Northern Ireland estimates that Japanese knotweed costs the British economy £179 million per year. And I'm sure that everyone here will agree that this is a phenomenal amount of money being spent to deal with what is essentially a biological pest and a nuisance. Japanese knotweed is classed as an invasive species under the Schedule 9 of the Wildlife Northern Ireland Order 1985, which makes it an offence to plant or grow it. However, there is currently no legal requirement for a landowner to control or remove Japanese knotweed growing on their property. With the issue being classed as a civil matter, there is little protection to stop it spreading from one area to another. Whilst it is an offence to allow the spread of Japanese knotweed, it can become a costly and lengthy exercise for an individual to take a landowner to court to recover the cost of removal and disposal. The area is fraught with ambiguity, and identifying the responsibilities for containment, treatment and disposal is a massive grey area. Legislation brought forward in England in 2014 and 2015 under the Antisocial Behaviour, Crime and Policing Act has gone some way to addressing the spread of Japanese knotweed and has introduced the use of antisocial behaviour orders by way of a deterrent and an encouragement to deal with the problem. I believe this approach is something which could be looked at for Northern Ireland and feel that the threat of the antisocial behaviour order on a landowner may in cases be sufficient to ensure that action is taken to treat the problem and prevent the spread. Further powers in England have been introduced under the Infrastructure Act 2015, which allows environmental authorities to enter into species control agreements with landowners and impose species control orders as required. Legislation in Northern Ireland does allow for local councils to enforce antisocial behaviour orders and address statutory nuisances. These powers have to date not been used to deal with Japanese knotweed, which I feel is an area which could be further explored. There is also scope for councils to intervene under the Clean Neighbourhoods and Environment Act 2011 by classifying Japanese knotweed as nuisance. Nuisance is classified as something which causes damage or unreasonable and substantial interference to a person's use or enjoyment of property. The potential for damage caused by Japanese knotweed must surely be recognised under this classification, and I would urge for the Act to be extended to include it and give councils greater powers of enforcement. Mr Speaker, the need for a regional programme for eradication is clearly evident. The recent case of Mr and Mrs Atkinson, whose North Belfast home is bordered by waste ground, which is infested with Japanese knotweed, plainly highlights the need for action. I would indeed.
The member for raising Mr and Mrs Atkinson's situation. I have visited their home, as I know the member has been in touch as previously as vice chair of the committee of the environment. This has caused considerable distress and anxiety to Mr and Mrs Atkinson, and I very much welcome the member raising it this morning in the House.
I thank the member for intervention and understand that it has caused great distress to this particular family. The ground next to the Atkinson's property is in private ownership and would require them to take a costly and time-consuming civil action, all whilst the plant is growing at a rate of up to 8 inches every day. They cannot cut it or try to dig it up, as this causes the acceleration in growth. The only method to try and eradicate is an expensive course of chemical treatment, which could take up to 7 years to completely clear the problem. Japanese knotweed is on the rapid increase in Northern Ireland, and we must take steps to ensure that we are preventing its spread. I'm pragmatic enough to understand that it may be virtually impossible to completely eradicate the problem, but I do think that this is a problem that we cannot continue to ignore. A regional programme could clearly be set out a plan to deal with the issue and how best to manage it, coupled with a more considered use of current legislation and clarification on some aspects of regulation. I feel that we can easily close the loopholes surrounding Japanese knotweed and assist councils in formulating a more strategic approach. In closing, Mr Speaker, the precedent has been set in our neighbouring jurisdictions. The legal framework is in place and the will is there. We must work towards removing the grey areas and make the treatment of Japanese knotweed simpler, quicker and less ambiguous in order to protect our precious ecosystem and the built environment. Thank you, Mr Speaker. I support the motion.
I call Ms Linda Dillon.
In my role as chairperson of the ERA committee, I'd like to take this opportunity to mention here that the committee has identified knotweed and indeed hogweed as potential problems. The issue was first raised at the committee meeting on the 16th of June, when it became apparent that practically every member around the table had issues with knotweed and or hogweed. When we questioned officials about it, it became clear that there was no consistent or coherent strategy for dealing with it. In fact, the department told us that despite recognising it and hogweed are species that, and I quote, cause significant problems operationally, unquote, they are dealing with it on a case-by-case basis. The committee was told that the EU has legislated in this area in terms of an invasive alien species regulation, and then in the same breath we were told that the regulation did not apply to knotweed. Later on we were told that other jurisdictions had a different approach, had tried a different approach, such as the use of ASPOs. To the committee and to myself, that is clearly not a satisfactory position, and so we wrote to the department asking for more information. We were subsequently informed that the Wildlife Order 1985 makes it an offence to cause to grow in the wild or release or allow to escape into the wild any non-native plant listed under Schedule 9 of this legislation. Japanese knotweed and giant hogweed are listed on Part 2 of Schedule 9, but the department's role is limited to the provision of advice and guidance on the management of invasive species. Again, I can state that the committee was not satisfied with the answer. We have now asked for further detail, such as statistical information on the extent of the problem in the north, including the number of known cases, the geographical spread of the problem and the financial implications. I look forward to receiving that information in due course, and I'm sure that both myself and the rest of the committee will be interested in its content. And in my role as spokesperson for ERA in Sinn Féin, this issue actually came to the floor of Mid-Ulster District Council in 2015 and was unable to be supported because there was nothing being put in place to protect people who may find themselves in the position of having this on their property or on their land and not able to deal with it because they don't have the financial capacity to do so. So I think whatever we decide in moving forward, we do need to protect those that may not have the financial capacity to deal with it. However, I do accept that that is no good to maybe people who live in neighbouring properties and their finances then are negatively impacted and that their home may be reduced in value and their quality of life is obviously impacted upon as well. It is a significant problem and we do need to find a proper strategy and way to move forward. I think that it's extremely important that we deal with this issue and that we do come up with a strategy, but one that protects all. Thank you.
Call Mr. Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the members for bringing this private members' bill today, this motion today, because it is something I think in our change from the business committee that allows more than one member to table the same motion for it to come forward, because it's similar to a motion that I myself had tabled, and also a private members' bill that I have indicated to yourself, Speaker, that I intend to bring. So I thank the members for getting this matter to the floor a little bit quicker than I was able to do. In regards to giant knotweed, I've heard the proposer and also the chair of the committee indicate the threat that this invasive non-native species has become. And I think where this came from through my own constituency was I'm actually working now with three cases of Japanese knotweed, but they don't afford the same actions that has been suggested either by the proposer of the motion or the chair of the committee or possibly even by the minister. Because what has happened now in the three cases that I'm working on have all been developments that have been built by a private developer who has brought in backfill from another site that hasn't been screened for either Japanese knotweed or indeed giant hogweed. So the two invasive species have become developed around those properties. The owners and the developer has declared himself bankrupt, went into liquidation. The liquidator has now declared non-interest in the properties because of the presence of Japanese knotweed, which I think the proposer, Ms. Cameron, referred to. Banks will not allow a mortgage on because of the presence of Japanese knotweed and the destruction level of it. So the problem then becomes for the neighbours who have bought the same properties in the same areas from those developers a number of years back, and they're significant developments, but because of what this one premises where giant knotweed, or giant hogweed, sorry, and Japanese knotweed has become established, they're now spreading into the neighbouring properties, into the neighbouring gardens, because as has been mentioned, these species, once established, know no borders or boundaries, and they spread at a significant rate, like 8 inches per day. Like the time I was out, it was even up over my head. So this species, once it becomes established, is a severe problem. But where I'm coming back to you, the research paper has been very dedicated and deliberate in what can be done in different jurisdictions. But it all revolves around someone owning the premises or having responsibility for the premises for where the Japanese knotweed is present. And we don't have a facility or a mechanism with any of our legislative forms, should it be at Assembly level, should it be in Council level, or should it be even through NIEA, for a requirement for that invasive species to be eradicated and removed because of the significant cost in that. And I think that's something I would like to see being brought out and teased maybe more out in the Minister's response to this, because as the Chair of the Committee has indicated, it's a problem that is throughout Northern Ireland. And I think even her own officials at the committee that day acknowledged the presence of it on their own ground. And again, they said they treated it by case-by-case basis if it was a threat to go onto a neighbour's premises, but only if and when it was that threat. So to remove the root cause, and that, I think, is the problem with Japanese knotweed, as the roots, because the root extensive system can go up to 7 metres down, so they have to be treated at a deep root level. It's not a matter of just cutting them off and moving on. Having interacted with the two councils that fall within my constituency, Causeway Coast and Glens and Mid and East Antrim, they would both like the powers to do something about it. But I suppose their answer is it's an Assembly problem. We don't have the legislation to be able to tackle it. But if we had, we would. So I think it's really coming into the position and asking the Minister to take that additional look as to what can be done when it's present on premises that don't have an owner. Because what I've got back from the Crown Solicitor, well, actually, when the premises becomes vacant and the receiver declares non-interest in it, it moves then to the Crown as a premise of bona vacantia. So it's actually the Crown has responsibility now for that premises that is causing the problems in my constituency. So I know some of our ministerial colleagues has taken on Crown responsibility. So maybe I could ask the Minister, in the case of the Japanese knotweed, if she looks to what can be done, especially when it is now prevalent in areas where it is causing a real problem to neighbouring landowners. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would also like to thank the members who brought forward this motion today. As you're aware, Japanese knotweed is a problem that's, I suppose, peppered throughout Northern Ireland, but we don't really have a handle on where it is most prevalent and where it is causing most problem. But as a member of South Down constituency, I can confirm that the problem does exist within South Down. Thankfully, to a small scale, perhaps compared to other constituencies, but nonetheless, there is that worry that it will spread, and preventative measures not being taken could make the problem much bigger than it is today. I thank the member for moving the motion and giving the backdrop, and I won't repeat that because that was quite comprehensive, and other members have indicated the strength of growth and the speed of growth in a way that I couldn't match, so I won't attempt to do that either. But on looking at the actual structure of this weed, I suppose it is to be called, it is quite shocking just how strong and persistent it is. And there's no doubt that any proposal to put forward, any programme, will have to be as robust, because it's not something that's going to go away overnight, and it needs something that we commit to in the longer term and not just the short term. Members will know that there has been work done in this House previously, and the previous Environment Minister did put forward the Northern Ireland Invasive Alien Species Strategy. Now, the objective of that strategy, I understand, was to halt the impact on biodiversity and the economy from the invasion of alien species. And there is that. There's that economic impact, again, which is largely unmeasured at this time. And there's also then that impact when that invasive species, and in this case the Japanese knotweed, reaches somebody's home. And a home tends to be, and I'm sure most members will agree, people sign up to a mortgage of 20, 25 years, probably the biggest single financial investment of their life. And financial products these days are understandably very flexible and mobile and allow people to move as and when life situations change. But when something like Japanese knotweed enters the equation, people's lives are literally put on hold. And the impact on their family, their life choices, the stresses and the worries. And we can't shift a lot of the solution to this to the mortgage companies. Mortgage companies are in the business of measuring risk against their loan books, if you like. So we need not look there for solutions. But what we do have to do is collectively look at what realistically can be done to resolve this problem. And I noticed that the Environment Committee did ask that research be commissioned earlier into the existing legislation across the lands in relation to Japanese knotweed and the control of spreading it into neighbouring properties. And It was identified at that time that there was no public assistance of redress for individual property owners, and that's a problem in itself. You know, somebody who has not got the financial capacity to deal with this problem has the frustration of knowing it's there and watching the problem become bigger as the growth spreads. The previous Environment Minister did ask the Department to undertake an analysis of the extent of the problem here, and I think that's perhaps one of the starting points we have to consider. The extent of the problem, I don't think, has really been measured yet, and perhaps that has to be our starting point. Where is the problem? Where is it most prevalent? And where do our resources have to be targeted? Then I would go on to say, basically, the commissioning of that official study we cannot pretend that we're talking in the motion about a regional strategy, and in the European context, I suppose there has been that acceptance that the problem is so big that it could not be eradicated totally. And perhaps because we're in an island situation, we could be more ambitious in looking at the long-term eradication. And that will, of course, include having to look at an all-island strategy on this particular problem, because obviously our neighbouring transport of lorries, which I believe is one of the carriers of the seed, or the potential carrying of the seed for this problem, it would be naive of us to have a robust strategy that did not consider the island of Ireland.
Ask the member to conclude.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will. So I would again thank the members for bringing it forward, and look forward to supporting any robust strategy to eradicate. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. David Ford.
Speaker, can I also congratulate Pam Cameron and her colleagues for bringing this forward today? I don't think there's any need to rehearse the points which have already been made about the biology of Japanese knotweed, save to, you know, to note that the research which is being done in England and Wales would suggest that the only possible control is to psyllid a Japanese insect which doesn't seem to thrive in the rather wetter climate of these islands, and therefore presents a problem for us on an ongoing basis as to how we deal with it. But I would like to look at some of the issues as to the legal options as to how we can deal with the matter. And I suppose I start by referencing an answer by the previous Environment Minister, who's just been highlighted by Ms. Bradley, to my colleague Chris Little in June of last year. The difficulties and the contradictions in our current law, as Ms. Dillon has already said, it is an offence to plant or cause to grow in the wild any plant listed in Schedule 9, Part 2 of the Wildlife Northern Ireland Order 1985, which includes Japanese knotweed. However, there is no legal requirement for a landowner to control or remove existing established areas of Japanese knotweed from their own land. Therefore, there are no enforcement mechanisms in place to control plants that are already established. And it does seem to me that's where we run into the difficulties which have been highlighted of individuals whose property ends up being affected from invasion from adjacent property. And the question is what level of legal enforcement we should have in this jurisdiction. We've had highlighted the massive blight which exists on property owners when people are told the value of their house has dropped, or even somebody is completely unable to sell, or in at least one case has been highlighted in the media, unable to obtain a mortgage so they could let that property whilst buying another one. Whilst the point is undoubtedly correct that operations would need to be addressed on a north-south basis, given what we see of the transfer of waste, including contaminated soil, across the border, there's actually a legal precedent which better comes from England and Wales at this stage to look how we might make progress. I wonder, for example, whether the Minister in her reply would be able to tell us whether she has considered the question of the introduction of ASBOs or the use of ASBOs on a slightly wider basis to deal with problems like this, and whether perhaps there should be discussions between her department and the DOJ in terms of how that might be done. Clearly, the possibility which now exists in England and Wales from the Infrastructure Act 2015 to impose species control orders is one way of addressing the issue of the threat from one piece of ground to another, and is something which perhaps also needs to be considered for this area. And there's no doubt that there is a significant role which the Department or NIEA could play in raising awareness of the problem, because there's absolutely no doubt that in many cases stands of knotweed get to a point where control becomes very expensive, which if people were more aware at an earlier stage, the issue of control would be rather easier carried through. So perhaps we do need to raise awareness by a little bit more than a debate in this chamber, and at least ensure that NIEA gets the opportunity to publicise it with perhaps even pictures or television coverage showing what it actually looks like, because I suspect many people don't realise what knotweed looks like until they find out the hard way of how it's affecting them. It's clear that we need to find ways which will stop the spread. Whilst legally somebody may be allowed to grow knotweed on their own property, there is a real challenge as to how that is done in a way which in urban areas does not become a threat to neighbours. And that is currently not being covered by the issues that we have. And in that sense, you know, the potential for those species control orders may be one way in which it could be ensured that action is taken at an earlier stage to stop the threat to others. Clearly, there are problems because so much of this happens on what is described as waste ground, and there is a real need for the department to take responsibility, to take action if a landowner is not taking direct action because of the potential threat, in many cases, to more than one neighbour, given what we've already heard about the dangers of spread. So there are significant issues. There are ways in which those matters could be carried out and charges levied using the English legislation or something similar on those who actually own the land. But there's also wasteland which needs to be addressed in a different way. There's a lot which needs to be done, and I believe there are both legislation and the direct action which could be done by the department, given all the constraints which I accept exist. But there is no doubt that otherwise small numbers of our people will continue to suffer from this invasive weed.
Call Mr. Gary Middleton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in this motion today, and I think the fact that we're actually discussing it here in the Chamber shows the seriousness which we are taking it and how serious an issue it is across the province as well. Japanese knotweed has affected and continues to affect many areas and properties throughout Northern Ireland. Whilst the full extent of the problem is not known, there have been many cases highlighted publicly in the media and through our own constituency offices, and I know my colleague mentioned the case of the well-known case of Mr. and Mrs. Atkinson in North Belfast, and it's clear the distress and the annoyance that is caused by this particular issue. This invasive species not only destroys native plants and reduces local plant biodiversity, but it also seriously damages buildings, land surfaces and infrastructure as well. There have been other cases where the knotweed has damaged flood defences and waterways, and of course the implication of that is the fact that it runs into serious financial issues and millions of pounds as well. As a result of Japanese knotweed, homeowners have found that it can reduce the value of their home, damage the structure of the buildings and create issues, as mentioned already, for mortgages when selling the property, and of course the very fact that it takes years to eradicate. I believe a regional programme for the eradication of Japanese knotweed would be useful and could help deal with the issue more effectively, and I appreciate that such an initiative would require much sort of attention from the Minister and much investigation as to the exact cost of such a programme and of course the legal issues as well. The concern for landowners affected is that they themselves are responsible for dealing with the issue, whilst high-level, widespread control is currently not the responsibility of any of the statutory organisations. It's even more frustrating when the issue is coming from a neighbouring vacant premises, and ourselves as MLAs know that when we're trying to get issues sorted with vacant properties or private properties, it can be very difficult in normal everyday issues, never mind dealing with invasive species. As a previous member of the Environment Committee, I did hear directly from those involved in the eradication of Japanese knotweed, an organisation called Knotweed NI. It was agreed that to effectively tackle this issue, there should be cross-departmental cooperation whilst also working with other outside bodies and organisations. As mentioned by my colleague as well, we need to look at other regions and other areas of best practice, whether that be England, Scotland or the Republic of Ireland. And I am pleased to hear that there is ongoing work within the DERA committee to look at this issue. So I just encourage all members here to support this motion. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. Oliver McMullen.
The issue of Japanese knotweed has now reached epidemic height, and there needs to be clear law on responsibility and duty of care. At present, there's ASBOs and civil law to deal with the problem. That's at a local level for those people not controlling Japanese knotweed when they could be reasonably expected to do so. So really, when we talk about ASBOs, we're talking about antisocial behaviour. And I don't think people can be blamed for having antisocial behaviour when dealing with this problem. Because the one thing that's missing here this morning, when we talk about the responsibility, etc., there's quite a lot of people out there who cannot financially deal with it, and that could be a problem, and how and what way we go to deal with it. Now, this plant was introduced here in the 19th century as an ornamental plant, have become so bad it affects practically every part of life, and to remove it leaves the landowner with considerable cost or fine. For example, it is estimated the cost of a reported $70 million to clear the 10-acre site for the London Olympics. The motion today, members, calls on the Deira Minister to bring forward proposals for a regional programme to eradicate Japanese knotweed. While I support the motion, I believe we must see regional authorities, councils and board as well. Members, councils are in a daily battle with knotweed, so their expertise would be invaluable in combating the plant. But one thing we don't have a regional map as to where this plant is actually growing, where it's spreading, so we can monitor the spread of the plant. There's a difference in opinion on the best way to deal with it. Some authorities advise, when asked by the public, spray with on-the-shelf weed killers. Other departments will have a different method. And really, we're still not given the proper advice, because we are told that the on-shelf weed killers that we can buy ourselves are not strong enough to deal with it. We must have a clear method of treatment and, most important, clear advice on disposal. At present, we're failing on proper advice for the public. And this is where I'd ask the Minister to look into looking at each council should have a dedicated member of staff who is trained to give the correct advice to the public. And I don't think we have that. We have some members of staff and councils who try their best, but they're not dedicated and they're not trained. We know that knotweed, when it grows along water courses, can damage flood defence structures, and this can reduce the capacity of channels to carry water. Remember, this weed can go through concrete, tarmac and other hard core surfaces, and the recent construction of the A8 motorway from Larne to Belfast, it encountered problems with this weed as well. If you're selling your home and your neighbour's property has a plant growing, this will devalue your property. Worse still, the mortgage company may insist on the plant be treated before the sale progresses. This could hold up the sale anything up to 2 years. The cost of this kind of treatment can run into thousands of pounds. Minister, at present, it is estimated it costs the economy here something in the region of $40 million per year. So any regional programme for the eradication of knotweed you must bring forward must have the input of all statutory departments and regional authorities. And also the cost of any programme of eradication must not be left to the sole responsibility of this Assembly or its departments. We must be clear on the law on this here, who is responsible. I don't believe you can have a plan for eradication, because it's quite clear we may not be able to eradicate this plant, but we must be able to treat it, and we must have the knowledge on how to treat it, and that knowledge is missing. It's missing from the local authorities, who are the people on the front line when the public ask for advice. So I would ask for that, Minister, that councils do take that on board. It could save a lot of money in the long run. And I do support the motion, and I thank the member for bringing the motion forward today.
I call Mr. William Irwin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And can I say this is a very timely debate, and indeed only last week I was approached by two separate constituents with regards to concerns over outbreaks of Japanese knotweed close to their homes in rural areas. In these instances, the weed is only a matter of feet away from their homes. And that, of course, is a huge source of concern for them. Also, in both instances, the weed is not on land within their own ownership, raising an important issue on who has responsibility for control and removal, given that it is not an offence to have Japanese knotweed growing on your land under current environmental law. The very word knotweed strikes fear in homeowners across the province, especially as the weed is extremely difficult to control, and is not something that the homeowner himself can effectively and ultimately eradicate without having an evacuation of the root system. As an invasive species, knotweed, like hogweed, and other species. Once established, spreads easily in almost any type of soil. When you consider that it is spread as easily as accidental movement of the plant stem, or indeed its root system, which can grow to a depth of 3 metres and 7 metres horizontally, it is easy to understand why it is so prevalent. Even the tiniest fragment of knotweed root can produce a plant, and that plant can then grow, regardless of soil type, by up to 2 centimetres per day and penetrate existing cracks in blackwork or concrete walls and foundations. People are most concerned about the weed growing in close proximity to homes, where there are many instances reported whereby homeowners have been hampered, as has already been said, in attaining mortgages and again in the resale of their properties if knotweed is close by to the properties. There is certainly a requirement for a renewed focus to work towards the effective eradication of knotweed. It has been referred to today in this chamber the fears of local residents across the province who have been unfortunate enough to be affected by this weed certainly do deserve some assistance in the fight against this highly invasive species. And many reports, as many reports have indicated, and as private weed control companies with experience in dealing with knotweed can attest, effectively dealing with this species requires a range of procedures, including evacuation and safe disposal of the soil for best results. This, of course, may prove a difficult but no doubt costly procedure, given the various issues with regards to access, particularly in built-up areas, and the high probability of surfaces running through affected ground. Soil which contains the root system has to be carefully removed and then disposed of within the current waste disposal regulations, and this obviously has an added cost. Regardless of these difficulties, I am of the view that as a legislator, we should respond to public concerns on this issue and come up with a suitable plan and procedure for addressing the issues of this invasive species that it presents, especially for homeowners and more move to an effective eradication policy. I support the motion.
Call Mr. Andy Allen.
Mr. Speaker, and I too join in welcoming this motion brought forward by the members. Firstly, I would like to welcome my party colleague Robin Swan's impending private member's motion. As has been mentioned, Mr. Speaker, the invasive non-native plants that cause most of the problems in NI are Japanese knotweed, giant hogweed and Himalayan balsam. In the last year since becoming an MLA for East Belfast, like many other members around this House, I have dealt with numerous constituency inquiries regarding knotweed, with constituents finding it virtually impossible to deal with the problem due to not being able to ascertain who owns the land the knotweed is growing from. We are also restricted on tackling the plants because their prevalence, location of breakouts are not recorded. In finishing, Mr. Speaker, if I might give the House an example of a recent difficulty encountered when trying to deal with the issue of knotweed. After many hours of speaking with Dara, the Council and other stakeholders, we were unable to ascertain ownership of a piece of land with knotweed growing on it. The best advice we could be given was to place a notice on the fence of the property or of the dirt or the waste land in the hope that the landowner will see it and act. This simply is not good enough, and we must do more to support those facing difficulties with non-native plants such as knotweed. Mr. Speaker, I support the motion.
I too welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate. Others have outlined the significant problems that Japanese knotweed clearly causes, and prevalence does seem to be increasing, so clarity is certainly required in terms of a strategy and measures that should be adopted to control it. I am supportive of the motion. I believe this problem must be tackled and a targeted focus is required to do so. As an invasive species, as others have pointed out, it poses a threat not only in terms of the damage it does, but also to our biodiversity. Protecting our biodiversity is a priority to mitigate against climate change and increasing threats from plant and animal diseases associated with that. The Biodiversity Strategy to 2020 was published last year, and protecting against adverse pressure from invasive alien species forms part of that strategy. However, Japanese knotweed is listed as one among several invasive species. The invasive alien species strategy published in 2013 set out a number of measures and actions which should be adopted to tackle invasive species in general. These include better awareness to identify the species, detection, prevention and control measures, management and communication, amongst others. In developing any strategy to control or eradicate Japanese knotweed, a first step should be evaluating the progress made against that strategy, and it is due for review this year. As the committee chair said, the European Commission recently published a list of invasive species around which the department is planning to legislate quite soon. However, Japanese knotweed is not included in that list, so it won't be subject to measures contained within it. Explaining its absence from the list, the European Commission indicated that the list was not exhaustive and other species may be added. There is, however, a need to consider, as others have mentioned, the legal framework for dealing with Japanese knotweed. As has been outlined, the consequences of discovering Japanese knotweed on either public or private land can be severe, and eradication of it from property proves very costly. This places significant financial burden on particularly individuals, and there needs to be some consideration given to that, especially as the responsibility for dealing with it falls to the landowner and stopping it spreading to neighbouring properties is currently a matter of civil law under duty of care to the neighbours, although I do acknowledge what Mr Swan has said about developments. In this regard, an evaluation of the control measures, legislative framework and financial considerations adopted in other states should be carried out to determine which are most effective. This would allow the strategy or measures put in place here to be informed by best practice elsewhere. Care must be taken to ensure such measures do not place individuals in financial hardship when placing obligations on them to deal with the problem. In conclusion, this is a complex problem and, as others have said, involves multiple stakeholders, including local government and other agencies. All of these should be consulted and included in any strategy being developed.
I call Minister Michelle McElveen to respond to the debate.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'd like to thank members for tabling today's motion. And I have listened carefully to the remarks made during the debate with great interest. And as a constituency MLA, I can cite similar cases and indeed concerns. The problems caused by Japanese knotweed growing in the wrong place clearly causes distress to individuals and to local communities, and also impacts our natural systems, including along our rivers. Evidence suggests that this is a growing problem, often triggered by changes in how properties are bought and sold. Japanese knotweed, as other members have referred to, it is a hardy, bamboo-like perennial plant that grows quickly and strongly. Introduced in the 19th century, it's invasive, spreading by its underground rhizomes or roots, and it is widely established throughout Northern Ireland. The species is widespread. It's especially prevalent on disused and unmanaged lands. And in such locations, particularly when ownership of the land is in question, and it is ambiguous or unknown, it is difficult for agencies or citizens to act quickly or not at all, and this has been highlighted throughout today's debate. And I recognise that this is a frustration for individuals concerned. It causes two principal problems. One, it impacts on our native biodiversity, and also the impact that it has on buildings and infrastructure. As members will know, my department works along with other agencies, including Transport NI, the Northern Ireland Housing Executive and councils. They're all involved in some way or another in trying to control Japanese knotweed, either on their own property or in partnership with other organisations. This activity often is associated with roads, rivers, greenways and other infrastructure routes. But the call for a regional eradication programme has no doubt been triggered by the more recent changes to property sales and the impact of Japanese knotweed growing very close to properties. I appreciate the concerns of individual citizens, and in this debate we do need to balance what it is that can be done in a strategic sense as well as what we can do to help individuals affected. The legislative situation in Northern Ireland is that under Article 15 of the Wildlife Northern Ireland Order 1985, and it is an offence to plant or otherwise cause to grow in the wild Japanese knotweed or any other invasive plant listed in Part 2 of Schedule 9 of this legislation. Anyone guilty of an offence under Article 15 may be liable on summary conviction to up to 6 months imprisonment or up to £5,000 fine or both, or on conviction on indictment up to 2 years imprisonment or a fine or both. If a landowner is disposing of knotweed or any other controlled waste by cuttings or by excavation, the Waste and Contaminated Land Northern Ireland Order 1997 as amended is relevant. This legislation places a duty of care on anyone who produces, collects, carries, keeps, treats or disposes of controlled waste to take all the necessary steps to keep it safe and to prevent it from causing harm, especially to the environment or to human health. At present, there is no statutory mechanism to compel an owner or occupier of premises or land to control invasive alien species such as Japanese knotweed. Given the current legislative provision in Northern Ireland, advice received from the Department's Solicitor's Office is that in cases where species such as Japanese knotweed are spreading from one property to another, is a civil matter between landowners, and I am aware of the issues surrounding that also. The effect of invasive alien species is internationally recognised as one of the main threats to the ecology of our natural environment. And to that end, invasive alien species features in the Northern Ireland Biodiversity Strategy, and this strategy is a statutory requirement. Some members have made reference to the legislative situation in Great Britain and in the Republic of Ireland, and each jurisdiction has taken a slightly different approach. In England and Wales, the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981 is the principal legislation dealing with non-native species, where it's illegal to plant or otherwise cause to grow in the wild any plant listed on Schedule 9 of this Act. Furthermore, the Infrastructure Act 2015 amended the Wildlife and Countryside Act of 1981, and this was to introduce new measures relating to species control legislation, which has the potential to tackle invasive alien species. These species control agreements or orders are made by environmental authorities to ensure that landowners take action on invasive species or permit others to enter the land and carry out those operations to prevent their establishment and spread. The intent of these provisions is to be used primarily to remove newly arrived invasive species or those of relatively restricted distribution. It's not envisaged that these powers would be used to control invasive species that have become widespread. Any action taken has to be demonstrated to be proportionate and cost effective, and to date my department is not aware of any cases having been taken. Also in England and Wales, there's a discretionary power to require the landowner to clean up land adversely affecting the amenity of the neighbourhood. This is under section 215 of the Town and Country Planning Act 1990. And here, local authorities also have the power to undertake clean-up works themselves and to recover costs from the landowner. However, the decision whether to take action in individual cases is a matter for that particular local authority concerned, which will need to take into account all the local circumstances. In addition to this, the Anti-Social Behaviour, Crime and Policing Act 2014 enables community protection notices to be served by local authorities or the police against individuals who are acting unreasonably or who persistently or continually act in a way that has a detrimental effect on the quality of life of those in the locality. The 2014 Act does not specifically or explicitly refer to Japanese knotweed or other similar invasive non-native species, as these powers are designed to be flexible and could be used to address specific problems caused by widespread invasive or non-native species. However, an information note has been produced on Japanese knotweed to accompany this legislation. Councils have used community protection notices to compel landowners to take action against invasive species, and a report in a recent Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors Building Control Journal stated that a community protection notice was issued in Peterborough on a whole street and an individual homeowner in Coventry who initially refused access to their garden to allow treatment of knotweed affecting the adjacent owner. In Scotland, the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981 makes it an offence for any person to plant or otherwise cause to grow in the wild any non-native plant listed on Schedule 9 of this legislation, and Japanese knotweed is listed. The legislation is designed to prevent non-native species spreading into the wild, but does not require people to control invasive species on their land. The Wildlife and Natural Environment Scotland Act 2011 amended the 1981 Act to include species control provisions to control or eradicate invasive alien species. And these provisions make it possible, under certain circumstances, to compel landowners or occupiers to carry out control or eradication operations, or allow them to be carried out by the issuing authority. The orders are intended to be used when it's been impossible to reach a voluntary agreement with the owner or the occupier, or action is urgently required. To date, we're not aware of these powers being used to tackle any plant species. With regards to the Republic of Ireland, the Department, if you don't mind, I'd like just to move on quickly. The Department for Arts, Heritage and the Gaeltacht is responsible for enforcing the European Community's Birds and Natural Habitats Regulation 2011, which contain provisions to address the problem of invasive species. Regulation 49 of the 2011 regulations relating to the prohibition on introduction and dispersal of certain species places restrictions on the introduction of any plant species listed on Part 1 of the third schedule. It is an offence, therefore, a person to plant, disperse, allow or cause to disperse, spread or cause to grow any listed plant species. And again, Japanese knotweed is listed on this schedule. The Department of Agriculture, Heritage and the Gaeltacht has indicated that it will continue to address the problem of Japanese knotweed on their own property, but there are no plans to tackle it in privately owned gardens. The legislative position in Northern Ireland is arguably less robust compared to GB with respect to actual powers to intervene in problematic cases where Japanese knotweed is perceived to be a nuisance to individuals or to communities. However, such legislative powers as applied in GB have not and are unlikely to lead to eradication there. While it's been suggested that introduction of similar legislative intervention might be a sufficient deterrent, there isn't a substantial list of enforcement case history to examine what could be applied in Northern Ireland and the relative cost benefits. I have asked my officials to examine the options that may be available within my policy remit and the consequential financial and resource implications, and that would include the potential to introduce powers similar to those available in Section 215 of the England and Wales Town and Country Planning Act 1990. The general concept of a regional eradication programme for Japanese knotweed does have merit. However, the practicalities of delivering in terms of the statutory basis, the likely resource costs, and the possible societal expectation that government agencies will intervene in other similar or nuisance species is something which we do need to consider very carefully. I'll come to cost considerations in a moment, but firstly we need to acknowledge that an intervention programme could require significant levels of enforcement type action given the individual rights citizens have on their private property. There currently isn't a statutory basis for forcing action on individuals to remove Japanese knotweed, and so any strategy would need to operate in a voluntary partnership type basis initially at least. The likely costs of a regional eradication programme are very difficult to estimate, not least because we have an incomplete picture of actual distribution of the species, and I know that that's something which Mr McMullen has highlighted, and this is especially within urban areas where the problem is more acute. Costs would be associated with not only actual removal of the species, for example herbicide spraying, but land searches, legal costs and restoration and reinstatement. Actual costs for eradication in individual cases will vary depending on the size of the infestation and length of time the plant has been growing. One published source reported a cost of £2 million being spent to eradicate Japanese knotweed in a 2-hectare development site in 2010. The European Environment Agency quote a figure of €175 million being spent in the UK on control, and that's not eradication of the species. Given some treatment approaches for removal of Japanese knotweed required 3 to 7 years, it would not be unreasonable to predict the cost of an eradication programme would increase year on year and would require ongoing budgets over a prolonged period of time. The question of whether there should be a regional eradication programme for Japanese knotweed raises interesting secondary questions about why this species and not other plant species that can cause damage, and whether this creates expectation and precedent that public resources are used in this way. Whilst departmental invasive species policy has been generally focused on impacts of invasive species on natural habitats and systems, it is suggested within the building industry that Japanese knotweed is a special case where the issue is one on people and property rather than just ecology. There are a range of other plant species that can cause damage and if growing near property, and some which spread directly and grow on property. There's also an expectation in society that landowners, property owners, act responsibly with respect to neighbours, and given there are a range of other species which readily spread, or if growing near property can cause structural damage, there could be calls for further intervention by government agencies to resource the removal of such species. This is clearly an emotive and complex issue. A broad-scale eradication approach may appear desirable, but would be very, very costly. Complete eradication would be practically difficult, if not impossible to achieve, and could raise expectation of future interventions. I believe that we should focus our attention on the worst cases, and in looking at the policy options, my officials will certainly investigate this. Any potential change or action will not lead to an immediate solution to those directly impacted by this species right now, and so in the meantime I would appeal to owners of land in urban areas, particularly to take control of Japanese knotweed and indeed other potentially invasive or nuisance species. I'd also seek information from citizens to record their observations. Such information could lead to a much more informed action at the local community and indeed inform a regional map, as was suggested. Our response needs to be targeted, focused and joined up, and I will be encouraging my officials to continue their partnership with other departments and engage with the committee and others where appropriate. Thank you.
I call Lord Marrow to wind up the debate.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I would like to, at the outset, thank everyone who took part in this debate. It has come across very clearly that there is an issue that needs to be tackled, and right round the House today that has been acknowledged. I also want to thank the Minister for coming here today and presenting herself, taking part in the debate, listening to the comments of all the members and, of course, speaking on this issue. This is not the first time, I think, that this matter has been discussed. I know when I was a member of the Environment Committee, along with others, it got a lengthy discussion and debate in that committee. And there is one thing that comes out very clear, that this is not a simple issue, nor is it an issue that's going to go away. Indeed, I think it's an issue that maybe is going to get worse as the years go by. So therefore, turning our heads and looking the other way is not the answer. It has to be tackled. There has to be a strategy put in place that is going to, in some way, tackle this issue. I think the Minister's right when she says, let's deal with the worst cases. And I think that's the proper approach. And I commend the Minister for saying and accepting that there's a big issue out there, but it is a very big issue, and we will not underestimate it. But we will also state that it's not going to be simple or straightforward, and no one believes that it is. I had a case in my own town where a developer was doing a development of houses, and of course the work had to come to a halt. And that particular scheme was held up for some 2 years because of the emergence or appearance of this knotweed. That, of course, adds to the costs and expenses, and we all know, all of us right round the House today, we can turn to situations where there is a housing need, and we have a massive housing need right across the whole of Northern Ireland, whether it's north, south, east or west. And these sort of issues do not help it in any way. They only serve to make a bad situation infinitely worse. Those who have spoken, and I must say, and I have to say this to Sinn Féin, they've been a bit more what I would call constructive today than they were when this issue came before Mid-Ulster Council, because one of my colleagues
brought a motion, and Sinn Féin said they couldn't support it because the Council couldn't do anything about it. They weren't being asked to do that. What they were being asked to do was to lobby the Minister and the Department. Now, I can't for the life of me, my mind goes blank who the Minister was at that particular time, but it was about a year ago or so, and but someone can tell me. So that might have had... But I think what Sinn Féin were guilty of at that time, they were looking at who was saying something rather than what was being said. And that seems to be a common fault sometimes here in Northern Ireland. We seem to look at who's saying the thing rather than what is being said. But that is not their approach today. They have manned up and womaned up, yeah, and they have said there is an issue here and we need to be tackling it. Mr. Swan referred to the fact that he's bringing a PMV, and I wish him well on that. And we look forward to that coming onto the surface whenever that day comes. And no doubt that will be a constructive piece of work, and hopefully it will go some distance in tackling the real issue. I think the challenge for the Minister and the Department today is our legislation as robust as that of GB? My information is, and I don't say this in a critical way, my information is that it may well not be. Now, Principal Deputy Speaker, I think there comes a time when you grasp the nettle, in this case, the knotweed. And I think that what we need to look at, where we are behind in GB and why our legislation is not as robust and fit for purpose as the rest of the United Kingdom. Somebody has posed the problem, the issue, and I think this was more of a distraction. Well, let's look at what the Irish Republic are doing, and let's do a joint venture. Look, folks, what we need to do in this country is look after our own affairs first. That's where our responsibility lies. That's where the Minister's duties are. And I'm exhorting her and her department to take a close, long, hard look and study at present legislation and see how we can come up to speed on it if we are behind. She did say also in her remarks, and I had noted this, that there is a summary fine of something like £5,000 or 2 years imprisonment, or worse still, both. I just wonder how many fines there has been over the past 5 years, indeed, if there has been any. Some say that if we take further action, that we are putting more obstacles in the way of farmers. I don't think so. And whilst I have the greatest sympathy with those landowners who discover through no action of theirs that in fact they have this problem of knotweed, nevertheless, as I said earlier, I don't think that turning a blind eye or turning our heads and looking the other way will be the answer, because this is not an issue that's going to go away. And I honestly urge the Minister and her department to do all that she possibly can in her tenure to ensure that this problem is tackled to the best of her ability. It is a complex one. No one ever said it was anything different. And it is going to be very, very difficult for the Minister and her department to really get into. But who else can we look to here? We can't. The cost could be, there's figures of millions of pounds being put out, that this is the sort of a programme of money that's going to be needed to tackle this issue. Well, let's deal with it. Take her lead on this one. She has said we will deal with the worst case scenarios first and then move from there. And I think that this Assembly today are quite happy to support that approach. But we do need to see change coming, and it needs to come very, very soon. So I thank everyone who took part again, and I urge the Minister and her department. I know they're not complacent to it. I know they are acutely aware that there is an issue out there, but I think in the past more could have been done. And I look now to the future, to more being done. And this House, no doubt, will monitor it closely in the weeks and the months that lie ahead, because it did receive a lengthy debate and discussion in the old and former Environment Committee. And I appreciate what the organisation that calls themselves Knotweed and NI are doing on it, but I think a new impetus needs to be added, and I believe the Minister is the right person to do that. Thank you, Principal.
The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it.